Hey there, this is going to be real quick. I want to recommend Nez's latest video. She did a break, real simple but beautiful breakdown of Acts 17, and she hit a point that I missed. That Paul tells the philosophers that we're all children of God. He tells them they're children of God because we're all created in Adam. Which is consistent with his theology of one man. We are created in the blood of Adam, meaning in his DNA. And that was before the fall. God created us good, said it was very good, and blessed them and sanctified that day in which he finished all his works, called it holy, and had created man in his image and called that man, which is a corporate man, it's the entire human race, the Son of God. And then man fell, we know that. But as man fell, he multiplied, and all of those that God created in Adam were distributed throughout the earth according to God's wisdom that they might seek him. They were distributed when and where they would be born so that they would seek him and groping find him because he's not far. God's foreordination of where we live is evangelical. His predestination or his sovereignty is evangelical, and it's out of his love for his children. And the angels were the sons of God, and a third of them fell. You think he wanted that? But the argument is, well, if something happened that God didn't want, then he's a failure. Are you calling God a failure? That is a really different way of looking at things, a very worldly way of looking at things. What God gets in the end is angels and men that understand his heart and know him. Okay? He reveals himself through this, and he has a universe full of beings that trust him fully because he is fully revealed. And there's no more question. The reason that angels rebel and men don't seek him is because they don't trust him, and it's because they don't know him. So he has an opportunity through this way to reveal himself. The universe is a communication, and the church is a communication. Christ is a communication. Everything God is doing is not to hide himself, but to reveal himself. But anyway, I recommend that video. It was really good. It was very sweet. And it reminded me that I'd missed that he tells the philosophers who are unsaved, unregenerate, that they are children of God and his offspring, and they should know that they shouldn't worship gods of, made out of stone, because they're people and God is a person. Then the other thing is, I'm not going to keep touching on this predestination thing, but I told you guys that what the occult view or the esoteric view in the Bible, what the way they view the Bible, and it's not that the cultists don't take the Bible seriously, they do. Westcott Hort were occultists, and they're the ones who translated the Alexander manuscripts, and that's where we get the NIV and the NASB and stuff. They were faithful translators of those corrupt manuscripts. They thought they were the good manuscripts because they predated the Textus Receptus, but they had all these Gnostic inserts in them. They're bad translations, but they're faithful to those, Greek manuscripts. The occultists believe the Bible. But what they believe is that it reveals or conceals an esoteric truth. And so what they see in the Bible is different than what a believer sees in the Bible because it's not through the lens of Jesus Christ. And they arrive at a satanic conclusion. And what I said is that this deterministic view of God, and I don't care about the determinism part as much as I care about the nature of God. And what's trying to infiltrate here. The nature of the God is that he's transcendent. And so they'll say he's good, but it is a good that is beyond what can be measured by good. And that means that anything he does is good. because he's God. Might makes right. And so I already laid all that out in my teachings. I said, you know, the in India, Sai Baba abuses his people that come to his ashram and says, well, I'm the manifestation of God. Everything I do is good because I'm God. Who are you to question? And that's how the Catholic priests get away with molesting children and making them keep silent for years, is because they believe they're the representative of God on earth and everything they do is holy. Their conscience is bound. Okay? So, because God is God, therefore he's good. And who are you to question? And it is true that God is good. But that goodness in the scripture is revealed in the person of Jesus Christ, in the work of Jesus Christ, and it's borne witness to by the law, and by our conscience, and by the commands in scripture, concerning our thought life and our heart and what we're supposed to think on and what we're supposed to meditate on and what we're supposed to view as holy and clean and good and beneficial and pure. We are given a standard of what goodness and holiness is. So an occultist won't come right out and say God is evil. No, they will say that whatever God does is good because he's God. You just don't understand what good is because you're not initiated into the secret. Good is transcendent, and it is a revelation for the initiates. Okay. Now, this is what Truthspeller said on his wall yesterday, arguing with me. Now, he's saying I'm slandering him. No, this is, he's teaching exactly what I said he would teach. He said, God is righteous and holy. He's trying to say, no, I'm not teaching he's not righteous and holy. And look what he says. The reason why we know that God does righteousness, or what is righteous, is not because of some criteria by which we measure God, but because he is just and perfect and holy and righteous and being, as a being, and therefore whatever he does is righteous. See? Whatever he does is righteous because he's the definition of righteousness. He transcends. And it's not according to your standard of what righteousness is. It's according to him. And if you don't know God, you don't know what righteousness is. That all sounds very good. But like I said, that's the same argument that the Catholic priests use. And then he says, God is going to... These are just clips of a post he did that somebody sent to me to show me that this is exactly what he's arguing. God is going to cast the majority of mankind into eternal conscious torment forever. And it's going to be God's actions that will be tormenting forever. I think he views God as a torturer and he's actually there poking people and jabbing them. No, it's a lake of fire. You don't get the sense that it's a personal torture. Okay? But he says most of mankind. They've both assumed that most of mankind is going to be there. And I've said many times, we live in the time where the Earth's population is magnitudes greater than all previous generations put together. Okay? The Earth's population at other times was in the millions. We've got 7 or 8 billion people on the planet now, and we're being plunged into the time called Jacob's Trouble, the Valley of Decision, where the 144,000 will be, and the two witnesses and the angels will be reaping the greatest harvest in the history of the world. And that harvest will far outnumber the Antichrist's army. There's not going to be that many people following him, but they have all the weapons and all the power. I believe that the number, the multitudes of being people saved will far outnumber the people that are not. Statistically, mathematically, I believe the number of Gentiles. See, these guys, when they preach the gospel to someone and they reject it, they think those people are predestinated unto wrath and that's it. They say, well, that's it for them. You can tell they're predestined for wrath, they're going to hell. Well, then that would have left many of us out because people preached the gospel to me for 10 years before I finally got saved. Paul says, you don't know if you're going to save your spouse. If you don't know if you're going to save your spouse, how can you say after one gospel session with a stranger that they're predestinated to wrath? Paul planted, Apollos watered, God gives the increase. You don't know. And there's been seeds planted this whole generation that are going to come into fruition during the time of the harvest. That's what it is. It's a harvest of all the seed that's been planted, that's growing together. We don't get to see the fruit, but we're sowing the seed, and we will rejoice when all these people come home. But anyway, his view is that most of mankind, it's very pessimistic, most of mankind is going to be tortured personally by God forever. God's character has already been declared as holy, righteous, and just, and is not on trial in the court of humanistic reasoning. Nobody did put himself before the court of man and was proved to be without spot by men. He was judged by Herod, by Pilate, and his propitiation is the vindication of God's righteousness forever, that he may be just in passing over our sins, and that he may be the righteous judge. Jesus is vindicated forever. He has prevailed. You know, weep not. The lion of the, John said, I wept greatly because no one was found who was worthy to open the seals, the book. And then he said, weep not. The lion of the tribe of Judah has prevailed. He has overcome. He's worthy, and he's proved it. And he's vindicated his right to open that seal by his righteousness, by his holiness, by his work, by his faithfulness. You know, because he hated iniquity and loved righteousness, God has anointed his head with the oil of joy above his brethren. He was raised from the dead because of his righteousness. He was vindicated. Paul says in Timothy that he was great as the mystery of godliness. God was manifested in the flesh, seen by men and angels, and he was vindicated. I don't have the exact verse in front of me, but it's 2 Timothy 3:16. Go look it up. He's vindicated. God is sovereign over the entirety of reality, he says, that includes good and that happens and the evil. Okay, now, here's where it gets real weird. God is righteous, just, and holy. Oh, sorry. Just because God creates people, evil people, that do evil things, does not make God evil any more than if Michelangelo carved a gargoyle made of rock would make Michelangelo a gargoyle. Okay, logically that doesn't even make sense, but there's a lot of weird stuff in here. First of all, he's arguing the way Tarantino would argue in front of the ratings commission. Come on, give me a PG-13 rating. Yeah, I know my stuff is full of gore and violence and the worst ridiculous stuff, but and kids, you think kids shouldn't watch it, but it's art. Who are you to judge? You know, it's not evil. Child pornography? Why can't we give that a lower rating? That should be for the whole family to watch. It's art. It's performance art. That's how they argue. So that was kind of weird. It's not evil if I make this thing. Okay, now the other thing is Michelangelo is making a piece of art that is a image of a demon based on what he knows exists in the real world. Okay. But what they're saying is that God, before anything existed, when there was nothing and everything was possible to him, imagined a demon, a scary, terrifying, filthy, unclean thing, and created it. Imagined it. Not only that, but they're saying that he created all the evil things. Which means he, before anything existed, and when anything was possible, and everything was laid open to him and he could do anything, he imagined, meditated on, considered in his heart, imagined, as an artist would, sodomy, pedophilia, Auschwitz, the Holocaust, Mengele and the medical experiments, Pizzagate, transvestites, and any other depraved evil thing that you can think of that I don't need to say. That God imagined it first, then actually created it. Not just as a work of art. We're not talking about Tarantino here, arguing about something that's not real, it's just a movie. No. God created it and made living creatures suffer it. Okay? Then, the lake of fire, for those he created to do it and forced into it. That is on a scale much, many magnitudes greater evil than Michelangelo making an image of something that already exists. You can't compare the two. Furthermore, what does this say of your view of humanity? Are we just statues and works of art? And this is the Gnostic view that the whole universe is an illusion, it's a simulation, and none of it's real, and none of it matters. We're just a computer simulation of some, we're some playground of some god's fantasy. We're his dream, you know? And, you know, I remember reading, before I was saved, I read The Vampire Chronicles, and in it, one of the characters turns out to be Lucifer, and he's fascinated with Jesus Christ, and he goes and he's talking to Jesus Christ while Jesus Christ is bearing the cross to Calvary. And the whole reason why Jesus Christ is doing it is because he's curious. He wants to know what it's like. In other words, this whole thing is just God's dream. It is a playground for him. And he entered it to get a taste. Okay? This is not Jesus Christ of the Bible. That I'm not saying that that's what they're saying, but to make it a work of art. No, these are living, conscious beings that have feelings. And when Jesus died for us, he identified with us because he loves us, you know. It's just, he is not a sociopath or a psychopath making works of art that he can torture for eternity. You know, living works of art. That's a Jeffrey Dahmer. Okay. And he says, the court of humanistic reasoning says that God cannot create wicked people to do wicked things in this temporal season of life and ordain evil, then destroy and judge those wicked people justly. The word of God says different. Now again, he has taken the words wicked, evil, good, righteous, holy, and just, and said they're up for grabs as far as definitions are concerned. You cannot discern the if you say that's evil, he says, well, that's just the court of human opinion. Even though the way I know what good and evil is number one, my conscience that God gave me. Number two, the law from the Bible that tells me what's expected of me. You know, again, God judged man at the flood, saying the imaginations of his heart are only evil continually. Well, according to these guys, God imagined all the evil that he made them do to begin with, and now he's grieved that he made them and he's going to destroy them. He's just as guilty, if not more, because they wouldn't have been able to do the evil if he hadn't invented it in the first place. And his imagination is just as defiled. Okay? This, now, I'm not saying that God is evil. I'm not saying that at all. This is what you, this is the conclusion they've reached. And this is why, you know, I think that they agreed with us about grace, and we died to the law, but it was for a different reason. We do teach on holiness, but we say Christ is our sanctification, and the goal of the Christian life is that Christ be manifested in us as life. We're pursuing Christ. This is something else. Now, whether they know it or not, it doesn't matter. They're reaching and proclaiming openly satanic conclusions about God. And they can call it slander. If they want to exonerate themselves, then they need to repent of this teaching and teach something else. Teach Christ and Him crucified. And I feel like I have to say this, not to argue back and forth. I'm not going to. I don't care what they say. But for people who are confused and think this is just an argument about determinism and free will or Calvinism or a secondary issue like you're babe in Christ and you don't know what's going on, this is not the God of the Bible. Okay? Greg Jackson's right. The God of Calvinism is not the God of the Bible. The God of five-point Calvinism, all points of the tulip, of absolute determinism is Satan. That is a Jesuit Gnostic infiltration. It's an occult esoteric view. And you know it's occult and esoteric because they tell you that the gospel is a secret and man can't know it and can't believe it. I don't think all occultists know they're a cult. I think some have just been deceived by thinking too hard down these lines and reaching conclusions. But people don't just get the Bible wrong. There's doctrines of demons and the spirit of truth. And we're to test the spirits. You know? And again, this is not about who's right about the Bible. I don't care about who's right about the Bible. I care about, do you see God in the face of Jesus Christ, or are you looking for God apart from Christ? And if you're doing that, and looking for Him in the Scriptures, looking for His glory apart from the person and work of Christ, you're going to come up with the God of forces. You'll come up to an esoteric or occultic revelation influenced by Satan himself. And it's going to stumble people. And it's definitely a divisive thing. And no, this isn't slander. And by the way, we didn't start this. You guys did. You guys started doing a slew of videos about us out of the blue. Just because Nick Getty and Greg Jackson were doing videos about Calvinism. You never said you were Calvinists. You never alluded that you believe these things. So, anyway. All right, take care.